Yeah, thank you for this panel. We haven't got a PowerPoint presentation because I was in France. I came home a day early from my holiday. So my wife has been left with a car full of suitcases and sand and everything. So I'm here instead talking about freeway fighting. To my left, we've got the legend, which is Jim Burns. And over here to my right, to your left, we've got my comic legend, Mr. Simon Colby.
Afternoon.
Who's the artist of the interior pages on Freeway Fighter. So, I guess if I'm going to do the comparing...
I think it's an informal presentation.
Yes, exactly, the informal presentation.
I think you're what is known as a moderator.
The moderator. So, let me start with how it all came about. The Freeway Fighter comic, my love of fighting fantasy, came from when I read, I think it was Forrest of Doom, my first game book that I enjoyed, and that sort of sucked me into the world of fighting fantasy. And eventually along the way, I got to Jim's wonderful iconic cover on Freeway Fighter, with all the lovely chrome and the girl with the, is it the morning star she's holding?
Is that what it is?
It looked like some sort of spiked ball type thing.
Oh, yeah.
And that sort of stuck with me, as well as Death Trap Dungeon, one of the other sort of iconic game books. And then from that point, you know, I grew as a young man, left the world of fighting fantasy, found girls, and college, and eventually came back to it, realizing what a mistake I'd made, that girls and everything in college was the wrong thing to do, and that fighting fantasy was my life. And eventually, I found my way into the comic sphere as a writer. I had tried rather unsuccessfully to become a novelist. Got some wonderful rejection letters, even from Terry Pratchett's agent, who gave me a lovely glowing sort of, look, this is a really lovely book, but I'm really busy with this guy called Terry Pratchett. Now, and then eventually I found my way into comics through my company that I was working with. There was a little comic company that was part of it, and I started to pitch ideas to them. And eventually, they took one of my comics, 45, and that opened the doorway. Fast forward, and I suddenly realized that I could potentially take a Freeway Fighter comic, or a Death Trap Dungeon comic, because I wasn't sure which one I wanted to do, and turn it into something wonderful. Now, along the way, I met Ian, he became a friend, and I pitched the idea to him, and I said, I need some money, and he said, go find money. rather than sort of giving me an open purse, of which I was very kindly, that somebody donated their funds to us. They were $60,000, and that allowed me to introduce Simon to the project. Now, Simon, do you want to give a little bit of background as to the type of comics you've worked with?
Sure, yeah. I mean, I came to this for a silly geeky part in my high school. Basically, it was Rush albums, and Walk the Far Top Mountain was quite big. Girls? No, Girls got a little bit later again, so I'm here. Which eventually led me through a failed career as a heavy metal guitarist. That didn't quite pan out. But doing the art for that band was noticed by Richard Starkins, an editor of Marvel UK at the time, who offered me work as an inker. Which led to, it's just turned 30 years as a professional comic artist. Worked for Marvel UK initially, 2018, DC Comics, all the sort of, you know, record comics you've heard of. And actually onto this, of course, Freeway Fighter, which has been one of the more recent projects.
Yeah, and the great part for me, especially as a real fan, was getting Jim involved. You know, that iconic cover, you know, how did you start? What inspirations did you have for it?
Well, first of all, let me just apologise for being a slightly fraudulent presence. Because the world of comics has always been one that's not part of my world, particularly. And the world of gaming, sorry. And I've never read any of these fighting fantasy game books. So how I originally came to it, it must have been, I can't remember, but I think Ian, we were friends, we were chums. We had gone back a few years before that, and I in the mists of time for 6 now. And I think Ian would have just, he knew my work, which tended towards the shiny and the metallic, was my only interests, machinery. I mean, before I ever came to art, I actually engaged with machines more actually in that my first career, before I ever chose to be an artist, but I wanted to be a fighter pilot. And I joined the RAF in when I was 18 and did fly solo on jet trainers, did all that stuff, like all that kind of end of heavy metal, if you like, the real stuff. And unfortunately, it was the world's shittiest pilot. So, you know, you can all sleep sound in your beds knowing I'm not above you. And so the interest in machinery remained, and it reflected in, I went to art college then, which I should have done all along, probably. That was a life lived by another man, basically, but a memory that I treasure, obviously, as a young lad. I couldn't even drive a car, but I was flying jets, so it's crazy. And it reflects in the work, that interest, which all goes back as well to childhood love of the work of people like Frank Hampson and Frank Bellamy with the Dan Dare strips in the early, the real Dan Dare, in the 50s and 60s. And so, you know, in the early 70s, I started to get my first commercial work through the Young Artist Agency, and it was in the realm of science fiction, science fantasy, that sort of stuff. And people saw my work as pretty good on the machinery, but that I could bring elements of humanity into it as well. So they've almost always got something human going on in them. And I think there was something that tickled Ian and Steve, I can't remember which of the two of them it was, that tickled their funny bone about, let's get Jim to do a cover. And so fighting fantasy, my Chevy, 57 Chevy with his modifications, I offered it up and they loved it. And that's my only involvement with fighting fantasy game books, but I seem to have been rather charmingly adopted by the community as someone who produced what I'm told is a bit of an iconic cover,
yes,
which pleases me mightily. But never any more work from them after that night.
You had the second cover as well.
Well, the Battle Cars, yes. That was created for, again, I'm having to scrape around in my, I should have done the research, but as you know, I've been on holiday.
Yeah.
I wasn't able to do the last minute.
Research. I know that feels.
I can't for the life of me, I can't get hold, so the memory is incredible. What it was originally commissioned for, I know it appeared on, it might have been just commissioned as a White Dwarf cover,
yeah,
Games Workshop, but since when it's found other places, including on the new World Technical Comics range.
Yeah.
Again, the same sort of thing, just great fun to paint, you know, sort of bashed up with a bowl of American. It's got to be American,
yes,
the car's got to have Americans. I can't, I think it's a Hudson, that one, it might be a Dodge. Tony Applin doesn't really seem to know precisely what it was. And they kind of forgotten them in the past until the rebirth, just a few weeks ago, when I was in the planet, so the relaunch of the comic. So here I am back again. But it all gone away. So I'm walking around in a state of slight amusement.
Well, it's nice to have you back.
Thank you.
So I just wondered if I could riddle on and talk about the comic. Or I could open it up and sort of answer any questions you may have.
Throw questions at us.
Yeah, because that may be better. I was expecting a compare, but there isn't one. So
I did say it was important.
So the first question to the movie, how big an influence has got Matt's been on this whole thing?
Inevitably it is. I mean, you can't deny it formed that genre to a large extent. I wouldn't say we consciously avoided it, we tried to avoid some of the cliché, some more obvious imagery. You can't avoid it, because it's a post-apocalyptic environment with mutant gangs, you know, you're going to stray into that territory to some extent. But we tried to find our own sort of token, didn't we?
Yeah, I mean,
using little references.
Stylistically, there's differences.
Yeah, of course.
And in the writing, there were several themes I wanted to avoid. I didn't want to see, you know, women necessarily sort of subsequent to a lesser role. I mean, obviously in the new Mad Max films, Furiosa's got a major part in that. But in previous roles, it was always sort of like Max being the lead character. And I wanted to make it more female-centric, and then we've got this really strong racing car driver that's got a good heritage. And it didn't necessarily sort of walk those similar threads that the old Mad Maxes used to. It was quite pleasing to see a Mad Max where he said maybe about 20 seconds worth of line. But where Mad Max was slightly different was that it focused a lot on the characters. I kind of wanted a story about a car. And to me, the Freeway Fighter was, it's all about the car. You're the driver when you read the game books, but the car is the journey. If the car fails, your adventure fails. So in the comic, I find that there's an arc that character takes, so much so that the actual Della Rosa, who is the main female character, the driver of the car, she actually has conversations with the car and talks to it in a sort of personified way. Only a one-way conversation, but in the same way I talk to the car sometimes, and come on, don't fail me now, I need you to go.
God, that's a nice way of emphasising how lonely a post-apocalyptic life would be. You would talk to your personality or the things around you. If you're stuck in a car for how many hours a day, relying on food to survive, you would give it character. I thought that was a nice way of emphasising that kind of environment.
Yeah, they talk back to you, no cars, don't they?
Yeah. Important times. But yeah, there's definitely influences, and to be honest, we played a little bit to the Mad Max crowd. We wanted to, not just be welcomed or something that would appease the fans of Fighter Fantasy, but would also broaden and hopefully strengthen so that we can do more. That ultimately, that's what we want to do, sort of open it up and make people aware of the actual, it's not just dungeons, it's not just goblins and stuff like that. That said, I've got a Death Trap Dungeon waiting for me in the background that I want to produce, which would be an amazing story. So, who knows?
What re-triggered was Fighter Fantasy? It went away for a time. How come it's re-triggered?
I think nostalgia. I think it was...
You had a certain age?
Yeah, I think I had my little boy, sort of 9 years old now. And he's into sort of reading, and I said, he's reading, he's reading Harry Potter. What was he wrong against Harry Potter? It's quite enjoyable. But at that point, I was like, you could read all of these books that I used to read. Now we can read them together. And I think that was my sort of starting point. I had these books in the background. I'd always buy a book and say, one day, I'll need to read them.
Passing it on to the next.
Passing
the torch on.
And then hopefully I'm getting to a point where you can read the rules for Dungeons & Dragons and then DM me. That's what I'm looking to do. I did it from a marketing point of view. It was all to do with marketing.
We did have a good discussion, didn't we? Yeah. There were others that we considered.
And my heart said Death Trap Dungeon, that's the one I wanted to do, but my head said Freeway Fighter, because I think it would have a wider appeal for me.
Yeah.
And it felt of the time, it felt right to do Freeway Fighter now. The other things that were sort of playing around was that I could only work the titles that were Ian's at the time. I didn't have the relationship with Stephen to actually do the other titles. So it was purely, Ian, what titles can I take? So he gave me them, and I went, I always loved Freeway Fighter, always loved Death Trap Dungeon, which one? And in the end, I my head said, go for Freeway Fighter, especially with Mad Max in the background, doing so well.
There's the zeitgeist, isn't it?
Yeah.
I'm not drawing another bloody car for as long as I can hold a pencil.
There were a lot of cars drawn.
There were a lot of cars.
And a lot of modifications. I think the first one was a little bit more BMW-ish.
Yeah.
And then we changed it and went a little bit heavier to an American muscle car.
I don't think when I painted that original cover, I don't think I'd seen any of Mad Max, but I hadn't seen the movie. And so it was like my sort of basically kind of battle car with spiky bits and all the rest of it. So I think that's one reason why people quite like it. It's kind of slightly different take. It's a little bit like he gets up every morning and gives it a bit of a polish, and the dents and the holes in it, they're kind of restrained, certainly nudged a bit. because he's a nice shiny.
Yeah, he's obviously, that car is obviously the alpha in the entire world. Yeah. There's about no, it's got dents and scratches, but it's like pristine with the old chrome on it. Any other questions?
A lot of framing angles very carefully, trying to use, it's called Dutch tilting in films where you tilt the camera and if you can create motion that way by tilting the horizon effect. Using tricks like that, tricks is not a technique, so to say. Using a lot of that, trying to choose camera angles very carefully. Using props like dust and bits of debris flying, anything to create a sense of motion really. Switching from shots inside the car to outside, to get perspectives, using really exaggerated perspectives. It's difficult to get that kind of motion, that kind of sense. You know, film, obviously, you've got the motion you can follow it. In static images, it's quite a difficult thing to do. It's a challenge. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, I think a lot of it's, you know, as Simon says, it's switching and choosing good camera angles. When I was writing it, I was making sure that there wasn't periods where it felt the same repetitive shot. There was always like a car shot from a distance or whatever. I'd always go, okay, well, we need to see the characters reacting now to something. You know, if there's people suddenly turned up on their tail, you know, I want to see eyes in the rear mirror looking at me going, aghast. So we would play around with that. Sometimes I would put a scene in and say, okay, I want to sweep in a scene with loads and loads of cars. And Simon would go, nah, right, man. And he would change it and put something else in. I'd go, oh, okay, that works better. I've worked with Simon many times now.
Sometimes it's just punctuation in the action.
It strikes me as very, my son is a storyboard artist, and it strikes me as being, I don't know if you're technically about storyboarding, but it seems to me to be a very similar discipline in terms of with still images to get the sense of flow and motion and drama and kind of like that. Very similar.
Yeah. But yeah, it's difficult. But hopefully, I mean, even down to what colourist does, adding in different colour hues and sort of affecting the inks, all of that will add to the dynamic nature of that scene.
It also isn't important if we're all thrash metal while I'm drawing that helps. I listen to that over
important. About 4 in the morning. Simon's not really working weird working hours. He sort of like goes to bed around about 10 in the morning. And then he usually works the night shift.
We generally cross over our emails when you're leaving for work as well.
So I'll be at 8 o'clock up here in the morning. I'll start getting emails in from Simon where he's just finished a page, and then I would, as that page would come in, I'd be on the train, basically putting that page into the comic and then lettering it, and making sure that it flowed with the script.
It works out pretty well.
Yeah,
it's pretty good.
I've worked with Simon now on 3. Well, 4 if you count 45, but
just
we've done Just Calls 3,
yeah.
Dark Souls 2,
Dark Souls.
And now Hero 5. But hopefully,
maybe the benefactor.
Yeah, you've got to find somebody who reminded you of giving the money.
Not me, only me.
So, any other questions? All the science.
I'm still traditional media, yeah, pen and brush. I do use digital tools. I tend to do my layouts on the computer, with a digital tablet, so I can sketch and change things very quickly. But when I've established that, it's always a traditional media, yeah.
It's very different for me because, you know, I don't work in the comics field. They've always tended to be one-off images for book jackets. And so I tended generally to make them into paintings because they have a marketable value as well. Actually, everything I've ever painted is sold on to a collector at some point. And I mean, I've run the gamut of early on watercolor and gouache, oils in the late 70s, early 80s, but acrylics ever since. But now, as the commercial work has dried up, I'm getting into more personal work using oils on stretched thin canvas. trying to convince myself that I've got some gravitas and seriousness as a real artist.
So what was the fighters, what was that like?
That's the Critics on Board. Lobby of Rushmore, obviously. Critics. I've always tried to, with the acrylics, get through the airbrush lots of glazing, transparent glazes. We can sort of emulate the richness of oils in a particular bar, and that's been quite successful. I think. A lot of people look at my work and think that's an oil painting, but they're not the acrylics. But look out for the oil paintings.
Any other questions?
I think we should say.